I'm going to aim to finish for six at the latest, so we'll try and rattle through the items as swiftly as possible. The attendance sheet's going around. I better sign it. Let's start. Yeah. And so item one is declarations of interest. Does anybody want to wish to declare any things that we need to record? No? Okay. Apologies. Okay, great. Thanks very much. Welcome everybody. Okay, item three of the minutes from the meeting on the 11th of November, which you should have in your pack. Can we agree those as an accurate record? So let's go into the first main item, which is the growth plan. And I've got Alan Evans. Alan, you've kindly come to give us a brief presentation on the growth plan.
Yeah.
I think you've given us copies of
some slides. Yeah, I've circulated copies. Has everybody got a PowerPoint? I've got more copies. Am I okay to sit here then?
Yeah. Hear me, okay. So that machine's there just for show.
I didn't know how to, yeah. I apologise.
Thank God for new technology, that's what I was saying.
Thank you everybody for asking me to present. The growth plan was developed back in the 2015. Just before I go into how we developed it and the type of consultation and analysis we did to develop a growth plan, just to talk a bit about growth really. Growth in this context is around growth in the economy. It's important we grow our economy, it's important we grow our business base, it's important we create more jobs. But growth is also around the other associated sectors as well. So, you know, we need to grow our transport network in order to keep pace with our business community. We need to grow our tourism economy in order to keep pace with what's going on across the visitor economy, across the Northwest. Growth is around employment, growth is around our business base as well. So that's the context of growth I'll be talking about today. In order to develop the plan, we did a full analysis of our economy and the associated sectors as well. So we did a full strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats for all of our for our economy and our sectors. We looked at the wider policy context as well. So we looked at what's going on nationally, what's going on internationally, what are the economic trends, what's actually moving within the marketplace, what are the government doing, what policies are the government introducing as well in order to help us to promote growth. We looked at inputs and resources, and I'll talk a lot more about that. We looked at not just the financial resources, but in order to successfully grow in an economy and grow those associated sectors, what do we need to input into that as well, and what resources can we galvanise as a partnership. In any good strategy plan, there would be action areas, so we've looked at what we're actually going to do in terms of geographically focused activities, but also themes as well, in order to deliver the growth plan. And of course, the outcomes and the impact are most important of all. Why are we doing this? What are we hoping to achieve through growing our economy? And then we also need to review that as well. So I'll talk about all of those briefly in turn. I think important, now I've explained what growth is, to look at why do we need to grow our economy? What are the impacts? Well, it improves the quality of life for our residents. So if we enable the economy to grow and we create jobs, people who are economically inactive can move into those jobs. Young people who have improved life chances have got a better chance of obtaining a job in a sector they want to stay in, a sector they will work in and grow in as well. We want to enable our economically active residents to access those jobs. So sometimes there's some support we need to give collectively as a partnership to individuals to help them find a sustainable job. And we also need to look at how growth is important to ourselves as a council and a wider partnership in terms of the declining central funds from government as well. So when we are reducing the funding that's available to us for certain things, for our services, for example, as a council, growth is essential to retain some of those services. So the fact that we can increase our business rate base, the fact that we can increase our council tax receipts are all important to us as a council as well, so we can retain some of our other services. So it's important in a number of ways. And I think, you know, just some context, it's important for Wirral to grow. This is an important agenda for all of the local authorities in England and Wales and Scotland. This is important that Wirral doesn't lag behind in some of this as well, that we are growing our economy, we are looking to develop new markets, we're looking to develop new activities in order to keep pace with everybody else in the country as well, because from the work I do, it's important because, you know, we can see what other authorities are developing in Cheshire, West on our doorstep, the rest of the Liverpool City region, but wider afield as well, all the other authorities that are developing and offer internationally to capture investment. The marketplace is taking off now. London is overheating as a marketplace in terms of the property market and buying and selling property. They've been sold so many times, there's no value left in that now, so the time is right to cease development. There are funds available, there are funds coming in, sovereign funds coming into the UK in order to invest in the economy, and we want to capture that as well. So we're all needing an offer, we're all needs to have an offer to be able to capture that investment, otherwise we will be left behind some of our local authority partners who've got a similar economy to ours. Our strengths, well, we are a growing economy. We are growing our GVA quite rapidly, and we had the second highest growth value added, so growth within our economy in 2013, the second highest in the country, which was good for Wirral, because I'll come on later to say we also have the lowest GVA in England at the moment. So there's a bit of a challenge and a benefit here, but we are actually growing, but we do remain the lowest GVA amongst the English authorities. We have a number of key assets. So we have a dock system that has seen significant decline in the 60s and 70s, but that provides a key asset as we move forward. So in terms of some of the industrial sectors we're looking to capture investment in, our dock system enables us to have deep water access to a river and a market internationally as well. So manufacturing can be, that's a big player in terms of capturing some of that manufacturing activity. So we have some key infrastructure, and the fact that Cllr recently won a contract for the new Polar Explorer vessel, that will be the biggest non-military vessel that's been built in the UK for 30 years, and it was secured by Cllr amongst global competition as well. So I think that's something that, you know, this area should be really, really proud of. We have residents taking advantage of new employment opportunities. As we grow our economy and we successfully recently supported companies in the offshore wind supply chain, we know that we have residents who are keen to take those opportunities. And a variety of employment opportunities as well, not just manufacturing jobs, but we've had residents who are keen to do that and showing a high motivation. We do want to support higher value growth as well. So, you know, by that I mean, if we are looking to get growth and investment into Wirral, if it was a big warehouse in the freight and logistics centre, then they'd be employing four forklift truck drivers. And what we want is higher value in our economy, so more jobs, more high skill roles as well. We have a good track record of enabling our residents to secure affordable housing. That is something, again, that the area should be proud of, but we need to grow our housing market, we need to build on that strength. We have very, very good relationships between our local partners, so not just our local colleges and some of our education providers, but we've got a very, very strong Chamber of Commerce in Wirral. We have good links to the Liverpool City region, we work very well with local enterprise partnerships, so they're all really, really positive strengths that we identified through the analysis for the growth plan. I mentioned the lowest GVA per head in England, but we also have low property values as well. So that is that if a new development cost £10 million to build on the open market after completion, it would only be worth £7 million. So there's a significant viability gap that comes into play in this area. It's a northwest, northern sort of problem, but sort of certainly prevalent in the Liverpool City region. So one we're looking to overcome, and one we need to sort of put some creative thinking together in order to overcome. We have high levels of deprivation and economic inactivity, so we know we've got sort of high pockets of unemployment, and we also have high levels of health-related worklessness as well, which we need to overcome. We have constrained development sites, so we have development sites which are there, but they've got constraints placed upon them, like previous uses, contamination. We need to invest heavily in order to bring them to the market, so that provides us with a real challenge. We do have some poorly performing town centres in the borough as well, which we need to look at, and I'll come on to that in terms of the action areas. And we do have a lack of higher value jobs really across the whole economy. We're very, very lucky to have some of the businesses like Unilever that we have, but we also have a lack of overall higher value jobs which we need to address. Opportunities, so that was the bad bit out of the way, but opportunities. Well, devolution presents us with a very real opportunity when it comes to growth. So the fact that we've secured a deal within our city region with government for devolution, which comes with some funding attached, is significant as we move forward. We do have a lot of activities in Birkenhead to rejuvenate our principal town centre, and we do have a lot of initiatives to look at how we help our local town centres become better performing. We've had significant improvements recently in our IT and infrastructure. So we've had a broadband project which now helps us and helps our businesses receive high-speed broadband, which is significant as we, as I said before, keep pace with everybody else within the North West. We've had a number of transport projects. This year sees a replacement of one of the bridges on the Ford Bridges transport network. So we've secured money to invest in our transport infrastructure. We're seeing value in our key growth sectors, so manufacturing is really good, mentioned Cllr, but we've also had some other big wins as well. And Unilever investing £40 million into a new advanced manufacturing facility has been a significant boost to our economy. We have a waterfront location. What makes us different from other areas of the northwest, of the north, and all the way around the country? Well, actually, we have a fantastic waterfront, as we're all. Not only do we overlook the world famous heritage site at Liverpool, we have fantastic views of the estuary as well. So that's a real opportunity for us to take advantage of, not just in terms of investment, but in terms of our visitor economy as well. We do have the UK's major regeneration opportunity in terms of the plan application that's already been given. Wirral Waters is on our doorstep, and we need to drive investment in that housing market I was talking about before. Our housing market is relatively strong, but we need to provide support to the latent demand that's there as well. And I will talk a bit about this a lot more as we come through to the action areas, but we have certain sectors such as digital and creative, but particularly around the healthcare sector, we have an opportunity to respond to the growth in that sector, both in terms of employment, but what that means to Wirral as a whole. And I'll talk about a few projects we're working on. Threats, just run through these very quickly. Well, actually, as a partnership, perhaps Wirral hasn't joined up as well as it could have done in the past, and if we don't do that, then we're going to miss out on significant opportunities. The whole growth planning process is about pulling together as a partnership more, so that's really important to us moving forward. We've never really looked at our place as a strategic way to look at shaping it. So where do we want the investment, where do we want the housing, where do we want the nice areas to live and to spend time in as well. So we need to do more around our place shaping. There are limited resources available to us, so we need to be very careful about how we use the resources we do have. There's a lack of approach in the past to balancing supply and demand. So we know there's an awful lot of demand for employment land in Wirral. We work with a lot of businesses who want certain types of premises. We don't actually have that in terms of supply, so we need to be much more astute about providing the supply to what the demand is in order to grow our businesses, attract new businesses, but also just to retain the ones we've already got. A number of other things as well I'll come on to. But the growth plan scope, all of that allowed us to look at the scope of the growth plan. And that was to create a shared ambition across all of our sectors, all of our business sectors, pulling out the key ones, of course, that would set us aside internationally and how we want to bring in good investment. We want to look at improvements in our infrastructure, further improvements in our transport, IT and housing infrastructure. We want to grow our tourism economy, so we want to bring people to Wirral. So I'm looking at regeneration, bringing people to Wirral, bringing visitor numbers is really, really important as well. Not only do they spend money, but they come to attraction, and it really puts us on the map in terms of where we want to be. We want to revitalise Birkenhead. That's got to be a key feature. Why Birkenhead? Well, Birkenhead has the potential to grow. We have the views of the Liverpool waterfront, as I say, but we also have other gems such as Hampton Square, a town centre that's primed for regeneration, and there's other civic communities we can do to really, really look at regenerating Birkenhead. We want to bring our businesses together much more. I mentioned before having a strong Chamber of Commerce, but we want to bring our businesses together more in order to look at export opportunities, really enable them to work internationally, look look at bringing them together as a consortia to pull contracts, so to do more with our business sector moving forward as well, and look at supply chain. So if we do have big opportunities in terms of a Cllr or a Unilever, or indeed, even though it's not in Wirral, but we've got General Motors on our doorstep, what are the supply chain opportunities for those companies, and how can we help in Wirral? And that's all about attracting new inward investment. So that's the scope. I won't read out the vision, but the vision is certainly to make Wirral a better place to invest, where a business can grow better, and take an advantage of our position at the gateway of the Northern Powerhouse as well. Northern Powerhouse is a big phrase that's used a lot recently, and it's about the Northern authorities coming together to realise more in terms of economic activity, and we want to be a real gateway to that. We are a port area. We do have all that water access I talked about before, so we want to take advantage of that gateway to the Northern Powerhouse. So that's a very much capture and a vision. It's just a statement around our ambition. There's lots more in the growth plan about how we'll take it forward, and I'll circulate a copy of the plan afterwards. But we do want all of us to come together to create prosperity for our residents and actually give better opportunities, better life opportunities as well. The inputs and resources, I mentioned this has been important before. I don't see resources, when we did this exercise on the growth plan, we don't see resources, just money that we can put to it. But also we need improved strategy in order to get that place shaping I was talking about before. That's place shaping not just for where we put bits and pieces and buildings and roads, but how do we get people interacting in our new areas, regenerated areas, how do we get people interacting in our existing areas better? We need an improved strategy to bring that place together more. And obviously interactions with the board like this is important for me as we move forward. Integration, well, we need to work with a much more integrated way with our partners. We need to look at the local authority about who's doing things, who can we work with, who can we work better with, and integrate our activities much more. And that's on a wider footprint as well, so the Liverpool City region, the combined authority and the movements there are really important to us. Working in partnerships, so I mentioned a number, but working in partnership with businesses as well, that's really important to us, working in partnership to grab that. The local authority isn't always the best people to attract new investment to the area, we can support that. Businesses themselves are the best ambassadors that we have for Wirral, so we should be utilising that more. Leadership in terms of this growth agenda is important, and I mentioned devolution as well. So that's what we saw as the inputs and the resources in order to take advantage of the opportunities we have. And that came to action areas, so what we are looking to do is break this down now as a growth plan into sort of more bite-sized chunks in terms of business growth. How do we get our businesses to grow? How do we support our businesses? Who do we work with in terms of doing that? Talked a lot about inward investment, but how do we get those businesses to Wirral? How do we get our transport network responding to what we need in Wirral moving forward as well? And that's not just our transport network for businesses, but how do people have better access to healthcare? And I'm sure that's something you talk about regularly as a board. Tourism, the visitor economy, that's really important, so is housing. And two, I really wanted to talk more about today and perhaps draw out is around employment and skills as well. So how do we get more people who are perhaps disadvantaged within the labour market? How do we get more people into the job opportunities that we're looking to create as well? How do we get that synergy moving forward? So that's what we're doing in terms of working up action plans. The outcomes around the 2020 pledges, very quickly, we need to create and safeguard 5,000 jobs. That's really important in order to create those employment opportunities. That we have a value in terms of how much we want to attract to Wirral as new private sector investment. We also have a target around new business starts. Our economy in Wirral is predominantly small businesses, and we want to continue to see that innovation within the small business sector. They are really, really important. Business starts, a new business, a one-man business could actually turn into someone who employs five people very, very quickly, so supporting those new businesses is critical. We want to build 3,500 new homes in terms of one of the outcomes of the plan. We want more young people in employment, education and training. That's critical. We need to speak more to our schools. There's an initiative called the Young Chamber at the moment about how we present some of these business opportunities. We're talking about how we look at opportunities within our private sector and presenting that to young people at an earlier age so they can make more informed decisions potentially about where they want to work and what sort of further education, if that's what they move into, how can a more informed choice be made in that area. We want to increase our visitor numbers to 9.1 million. It's currently around about 7.5, so that's a real challenge moving forward, but one I think we can respond to. And visitors, as I said before, do actually spend more. And then we have a 98% high-speed broadband target, which we've almost hit already in improved quality of life is one of the big impacts we want to achieve through those outcomes. Hopefully, if people have more financial stability, economic independence, then that does help towards higher life expectancy. We also want to grow our employment numbers, people to have higher incomes, which leads to less deprivation, and that raises aspirations of young people. They're all the impacts we want to achieve through this growth plan. So it's not just about £250 million worth of private sector spend, but if we do get those jobs and we get those businesses, what does that mean in terms of the impact of rural residents as well? The wheel is just an attempt to show how all of these action areas fit together. So it shows that actually all of those things need to turn, that wheel really needs to work together. All of those areas, when we talk about regeneration, we need to talk about tourism, we need to talk about transport. And then on the outer side of that wheel, we'll talk about Birkenhead Town Centre, Wirral Waters, the A41 corridor, and the area around Birkenhead being the growth, the areas with the most growth potential. And then finally, where we're taking this now is we are going to develop those action plans, working with our partners. We need more action plans around those areas I talked about. And we want to bring back monitoring and reporting as well, because it's important we do actually start to capture how we're achieving those outcomes, but how we're achieving that impact as well. And we can do that through a variety of ways, and joining up with boards like this in terms of economic profiles, case studies of how we've helped people into employment and what's worked, and evaluations on that activity are really important as part of the ongoing monitoring and evaluation of the growth plan as well. So that's a whistle-stop tour, sorry for running through it very, very quickly. That's a whistle-stop tour in terms of how we've developed the growth plan. Some of the projects I want to talk very quickly about are around our high streets, so working with public health colleagues at the moment to look at healthy high streets, how we take forward a healthy high streets initiative. That links into some regeneration initiatives. We've done an awful lot around local town plans, town centre plans, how we can support local businesses to grow within a local centre context. And we want to join up those initiatives really, because I think we should be doing that. This is about improved opportunities within our local town centres. So the Healthy High Street is an initiative I really want to work closely with. And as we develop work streams at a council, we want to pull our colleagues, particularly from public health, but wider afield into that initiative as well. And then finally, there's one project within Wirral Waters. We all know what Wirral Waters is, probably in terms of Peel Holdings, £4.5 billion worth of investment over the next 25 years. What does that mean in the next couple of years? Well, actually, we've got, well, we've had one project, new campus Wirral Met, which has gone up, that's gone live now. Students started studying at the college campus in September, which was fantastic. Another project we want to bring forward and go live in terms of spades in the ground at the end of this year is a university health campus. So Wirral Met are working actively with University of Chester to look at the skills required for the health sector around midwifery, around dementia, around other activities as well. And we wish to bring a project like that into Wirral Waters because I think it's the right location. It's a good place to have an educational quarter with the Wirral Met activity as well. So Peel Holdings are working as a developer with the two, with Wirral Met College and also with the University of Chester. And there's a bid into the Liverpool City Region Skills Capital Fund. That's gone through the first phase, and the second part of the bid is being submitted anytime soon. And if that was to be supported, work would start on site at the end of this year, the practical completion at the end of next summer. So that would be a really big benefit to what we're doing, not in terms of regeneration, only in terms of regeneration, but in terms of what it means for across the partnership as well. So that's a project that I wanted to put out. I will take any questions. I've got a bit more information if anyone wants to know more about that. But I'd certainly like to come back, perhaps with future board to let you know the outcome of that funding decision.
Thanks, Alan. That's canter through. I thought you might mention the, which is a really good project, the health-related worklessness.
Yeah,
a bit of interest for this board.
Yeah, we have high levels of worklessness in Wirral, significant high levels of worklessness, and the work we've been doing with public health colleagues is to do some insight around worklessness in general. And one of the big numbers within that worklessness is people with a health-related condition and why they are not currently economically active. And we really, really had some really amazing insights really into how people feel disenfranchised from the services around them, how they don't feel that there's no jobs, so why would they engage in services but looking to make them more employable because there's no jobs at the end of it. So some real desperate sort of stories that we've heard, why people don't interact with services were available to them. We know that one in 17 people nationally who have a working age population suffer from a health-related condition. In Wirral, that's 1 in 10, and in Birkenhead, it's 1 in 10. So we know that in some of our areas, that's really acute as well. So this insight has been really helpful to colleagues in public health and with me and the investment side, because we've moved forward and jointly commissioning some activity to look at how the partners work better together to try and engage people in a more consistent way, really. DWP offer a lot of services, obviously, in that area. GPs do an awful lot of work around people with health-related conditions. How can we join up these areas better? And we've done some work. We are going to go forward and commission some work in this area. But I think it's a good piece of joint working that we've done to date, just to understand this area a lot more. And I can send around some of the activities and some of the insight that we've got, perhaps.
We've got some money, haven't we, from the government to develop this?
Yeah, last year.
Something called the Public Service Transformation Programme?
Yeah, and we secured £1 million at the back end of last year to actually help us with this activity, and there's some more money from public health as well, so we've sort of jointly looked at what we can put together to commission activity around this area.
And as well as getting people back into the labour market, there were huge savings to be made into the Exchequer.
Some staggering statistics really that we knew were there but we've really drawn out. So an awful lot of people who were classed as workless and have a health-related worklessness condition, their age between 25 and 49 as well, so they've got a significant proportion of their working age life left to offer, and that's quite staggering in terms of some of the statistics. So that 1.4 million will really help us to try and galvanise some of our partnerships, do some innovative working, get out there and co-design some services as well, third sector as well, in order to put some more activities on the ground that are making a difference.
And it's a good programme because my fear is that the agencies like DWP and the private companies that have been brought in by the government on the work programme give lots of money. And I understand why they're doing this. They go for the low-hanging fruit, the easy wins, whereas actually there are lots of people who've been out of the labour market for years. Yeah. And it's a generational thing, actually, within families. So this project is to try and particularly focus on that group within the within Wirral.
Absolutely. Yeah. And the figure you mentioned, we know that £70 million worth of into Birkenhead alone, in order to that's the benefit cost, if you like, to what happens in Birkenhead. So if we can make inroads into that and help people back into work, then obviously have a positive impact on the overall.
Okay, all right. So let's have any contributions, Greg.
Okay, David, starting off.
Yeah.
Alan, it's great that you're here. I think that for us to be talking about the growth agenda at the Health and Wellbeing Board, I think is a great thing for us to be doing. I think that we often think about this, the kind of health and care area, as an area of deficit. We think about shrinking budgets, we think about the national agenda in terms of having less money. But actually, it's a really big part of business locally. David's probably the biggest employer in Wirral. So I think we do need to be thinking about the system in different ways. You know, there's over £800 million of investment and work there. So you know, I think this is an opportunity to start the ball rolling in terms of that type of thinking. There are loads of jobs in care, there are loads of jobs in health and in nursing, and we're struggling to get people to do those sorts of roles. So let's really get a grip of that agenda and look at it in a very positive way. And I think what you said about the skills centre being part of Wirral Waters could be really good in terms of that. But it does strike me there's a lot of people sat at home without a job, that really if we can get them in the right kind of frame of mind to look at these roles and get involved, then you know, we can potentially have some very good outcomes for people. So it is about turning the coin on the other side and thinking about it. You know.
And just on the health and skills agenda, we have a pledge within the Wirral plan around making sure that our skills meets the needs of businesses as well. So we're going to look at getting the University of Chester to really, really interrogate what our skills University of Chester do a bespoke piece of research to look at what the school's requirements are, to look at how we can take that forward. Sue Higginson is the pledge lead for that particular one. So if it is of interest to people, then when we do look at that brief, I can circulate it.
Just echoing what Claire said about really, really good to see you here, because it is about our broad focus on health and wellbeing, not just a narrow focus on health and social care. And there's a question, I suppose it's a question to yourself, Alan, about what do you see the role of this health and wellbeing board in supporting you in terms of the growth strategy and the growth agenda? We've referenced health related worklessness, which is clearly a biggie for us, and we've got some key colleagues involved like DWP, we've got GPs, but it might be that we can help unlock some things in terms of the key roles that we have around the table. There might be other things that you feel it would be helpful for us to provide support to you on. You may not be able to answer that now, but I suppose it's an offer really, and a question as well.
I think that's it. For me it's around, I mentioned place shaping, as we look at Wirral as a place, as we look at somewhere like Wirral Waters and what does Wirral Waters mean, I think I'd like to engage the board more in how we start to bring that investment, what it looks like, how do we want people to interact in that space, what does that mean for older people, what does that mean for younger people, and really start to get that agenda around the shaping going, if that makes sense. Claire, I'd really appreciate the chance to come back and maybe with Neil or some more wider regeneration issues and talk about some of the projects, what they look like. Everyone's view on what those places look like and how we can perhaps all impact more on taking that forward.
June?
Again, like everyone said, really welcome you coming. I think one of the pledges that I've been leading on and working with Sue Higginson on also is that young people are ready for work and adulthood. And we know that there are a good number of young people who struggle with this gap in attainment and their capacity to secure jobs, and whilst that's getting better, we just really welcome linking in with the whole growth agenda so that we can look at youngsters who actually fare better through a vocational route, as well as those, particularly with the selective education system, who are destined more for an academic or university route. So it's just been able to reflect that diversity and just, you know, that saying almost, I can't probably remember it, but a job is one of the best health determinants also. I'm just thinking about general health and well-being of our next generation. So it's really important that we don't keep this agenda.
Okay,
Dan.
Thanks. From a community perspective, we're working with the college on developing a health and care course, which is a foundation degree course, to encourage young people to think about care and health as a real opportunity, but perhaps they haven't quite reached the level of education attainment that we could. And so I think that's a really, really good platform, because it will bring opportunities for younger people. It will give them opportunities to do some place-based education as part of that course as well, so that they get a broad breadth, so that they're not just thinking about, well, is it health or is it social care, but we're actually bringing two sets together, because there's an awful lot of transferable skills that we can, you know, wrap around the jobs, and then we can start to think about, so what new roles can we develop on the back of that. So we're hopeful that the first courses will be available from September. So again, that needs to be linked in as an opportunity to widen that.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not Jackie. I think, you know, from, you know, we know that a large number of people who have health-related worklessness, as you mentioned, will have mental health problems, and actually the other way around, where you have, you know, a large number of people with mental health problems will have worklessness, if you like. Now, we have various initiatives within Cllr, which I'm just wondering how we can actually link in and help you to kind of, from the research point of view, there's also a large body of research nationally, which has looked at this. And we have links with the Academic Health Science Network and Cllr in Liverpool. So I'm just thinking in terms of how, you know, in terms of how we can help you, but not to repeat the same research again.
Absolutely.
And again, in terms of reducing the, you know, so we spend many years just relooking at the same thing.
Uh,
David.
The positive comments made, I think this is, it is good to have this discussion here. From a Wirral Hospital's point of view, we're probably spending in excess of £30 million a year on services and products. And again, how can we use that to really support this agenda? I've been in discussions today about commercial opportunities that we think we have that could grow our income from commercial opportunities, but could grow jobs and things as well. But again, we're not connected to anything. We're very much trying to do all of this in isolation. So any opportunity to try and connect in with some of the bodies that you've mentioned, Alan, would be helpful, because again, it would be in our mutual best interests to do that. The other thing I would say is we just have to think through, if we are looking at something like 5,000 more jobs, 3,500 more homes, then that's possibly a 3 or 4% increase in the population. We just need to factor that into our modelling, because that's a step change on top of demographic growth, and we just need to understand what that means for services. I'm not saying it's not all very positive, but what I don't want to do is to find that we end up getting the demand and we're not on the front foot in terms of whether it's GP services, hospital service, whatever. And we just need to make sure we've modelled that into our thinking.
My point entirely, I think it was around recruitment to GPs, primary care. We're trying to explore some sort of primary care academy, because primary care itself has no postgraduate training. I think it's something we could link in with you in Chester as well. Mm-hmm. So I just think it's great that we've got a connectivity here. Mm-hmm. And this is the kind of discussion we should have. Mm-hmm. Exactly here. I think we're very lucky to have you, Alan, as well. And I think it's a really good opportunity to have this forward view of what growth might look like for us. But for us, in terms of service delivery, to be able to say, well, how are we going to respond to that and factor that into our plans? Because that is an increase in referrals, and we need to factor into that. What's the potential behind that? So, and of course, more visitors is really good, but then we need to have more emergency services available at those weekends for visitors and plan all those in. So it's a good opportunity to make sure we're joined up. So it's great.
Okay. Right. Annette.
I just want to fly the flag
of
the system, really, because some of the organisations that we work with are small businesses and would have an input. And also volunteering is a really good way into employment. So it's all connected, isn't it? I just don't want to be forgotten.
No, I don't know.
Sorry?
I know one of the threats you mentioned, Alan, would be further reductions in adult skills budgets. And I mean, been sort of 50-60% reduction in that, and it seems awful really at this point, you know, when you're talking about we need the skills and that. I mean, we've run a little project down on the Wood Church, you know, over the last 2 years, giving people the opportunity to do maths and English at GCSE. Now these are people in their 40s and that, who want to come back into the job market, but you do need, you know, sort of a C at least in maths and English. And in an environment where people are not sort of under pressure in the school situation or that, but in a very sort of calm, and these people are taking this opportunity, you know. And I just think, you know, with the budgets being reduced and that in colleges and that, you don't seem to be able to encourage these people to come into colleges. And I'd like to see sort of little areas where this was done, you know, but the budgets are being cut all the time. So, you know, there's no money to do these things. So you're having, you know, David has got to bring people in, I imagine, from other countries. Whereas, you know,
well, we're certainly recruiting nursing staff from Portugal, from Spain, from Poland.
Yeah. I mean, the women who are on the course and the men were all saying they wanted to go into social work, or they wanted to go into nursing or midwifery or whatever. That was 20 people. You know, and I'm sure if you had had the money there, the budgets, you know, we had the budgets weren't being cut all the time, you know, we have this opportunity. Again, I don't exactly know where this money is coming from the 3 million apprentices, you know, that the government is saying, you know, that should be used, shouldn't it, in this particular way? So it's actually trying to get central government to come and look at it. Before Esther McVeigh actually lost her job, she came and had a look at the project down on the church and said, oh, that's really good. But, you know, she's gone now and, you know, other ministers disappear, and if you're in opposition, it's very, very difficult to get the message across. I think it's wonderful what you're trying to do. So I'd like to see our people in this particular area being given an opportunity to, you know, upskill themselves and get into the job market.
Absolutely, and I think there's an opportunity through the area-based review going on at the Liverpool City region to make sure we feed as much as we can into that.
I remember from 17, the City region will have control of the whole of the post-19 skills budget that did all through it. So the money may be going down, but we will have
Thank you. I really welcome this, and the key to this, as far as I can see, is connectivity. It's joining the dots. It's looking through all the implications of everything. So from a primary care point of view, I absolutely right, John and David, to think ahead of the implications of additional housing. But I was also sitting here thinking of the proportion of time in primary care that is taken up by repeat attendance due to mental health issues caused by worklessness, and the other way around, health problems causing worklessness and the knock-on effect of that. So if we can work to achieve some benefit from that sort of thing and the right people to connect them with to make movement, then we create some space in primary care, which then has a knock-on effect on being able to handle the increased housing. So it's complex, but I think it needs a great deal of working through. I mean, it's making those connections that's vital.
Okay, anybody else? Fiona, sorry.
Sorry, I'm just
saying.
The best for last. I've been obviously very happy with the conversation and good to hear that conversation, and as well recognising the value of this conversation and the value of making sure we follow through on this conversation actually. And what I just wanted to say was I think we need to wait to take all these opportunities forward. And I didn't know, Alan, if there were some things or some ways in which you would like people round the table to either. All during the discussion, but how do we realise that? How do we make that happen? Because otherwise, it's a good conversation, but it still doesn't help you with the agenda. I mean, the opportunities that are very, very clearly there. So that was one key question that I wanted to ask. And then the second one is, I wondered whether we can reflect on how we can support you in that sense of we're all being a great place to do business. Because it's underpinned by terrific health services, it's underpinned by all sorts of other things. How do we help you get that message out that it's a good place? Because it would benefit us if we can get that right. And as employers as well, thinking